Please rise and open your hymnals to hymn 720, We Are Called.
Thank you.
turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Gracious God,
have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done, and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you, and hold us by your Spirit, so that we may live in newness of life, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin, and made us alive together with Christ. By grace we have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen us with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in our hearts through faith. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the community of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Draw your church together, O God, into one great company of disciples, together following our teacher, Jesus Christ, into every walk of life, together serving in Christ's mission to the world, and together witnessing to your love wherever you send us. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Thank you. first reading is from 1 Kings chapter 19. He said, "Go out and stand on the mountain before the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by." Now there was a great wind, so strong that it was splitting mountains and breaking rocks in pieces before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a sound of sheer silence. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. Then there came a voice to him that said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please read Psalm 85 responsibly. Let me hear what God the Lord will speak, for he will speak peace to his people, to his faithful, to those who turn to him in their hearts.
Surely salvation is at hand for those who fear him, that his glory may dwell in our land.
Steadfast love and faithfulness will meet. Righteousness and peace will kiss each other.
Faithfulness will spring up from the ground, and righteousness will look down from the sky.
The Lord will give what is good, and our land will yield its increase.
Righteousness will go before him, and will make a path for his steps.
Would you please rise for the gospel proclamation? $500 from every congregation felt like an ambitious goal.
But they decided to do it anyway, even though some expressed concerns. You know, those little congregations might not be able to do that, someone said. Or they might feel like they're being asked to give more than they can, and, well, should we do that to them? But then they said, let's just give people the opportunity. Let's just try it. So for every $500 the congregation raised, they were to receive a plywood cow that they could decorate with the name of their congregation on it. If more than $500 was raised, you'd have two cows for $1,000, three cows for $1,500, and one up. The committee decided it is the most faithful, basic way of asking our congregations to be Christians. After all, we're talking about following Jesus, who fed 5,000 in the desert, and who feeds us all with his body and blood every time we gather. So giving through ELCA World Hunger seems like a pretty good way to be faithful. The committee didn't know what would happen after that. They made up a super fancy flyer. It says, Holy Cow, have you heard, H-E-R-D, we're on the move to stomp out hunger. Then they sent them to every congregation with the invitation to raise the money and gave everyone a wooden cow. It looks like we will probably have at least 200 of these cows instead of just 74 coming to Synod Assembly. We have some congregation, and it matters not how big they are, who have raised between 10 and 20 cows of money. So that's $5,000 to $10,000 coming from them for ELCA World Hunger. It's just been amazing. Even more amazing is that the enthusiasm and excitement has just built and built on itself. Unlike many things that are gimmicky, it hasn't fizzled out. We haven't reached a saturation point, that unpredictable moment when the enthusiasm wanes and an idea has lived its life, done all it can, reached its full potential. I thought about why, and then I thought, maybe faithfulness doesn't have a saturation point. What we've seen happen can be called the herd mentality, literally and figuratively in our case. But typically, herd mentality is used to describe bad events in our lives, like gang rape, which always leaves us asking, wasn't there just one person or one ounce of decency that if it spoke up may have changed the outcome in such a tragic situation? Some have described Hitler's Germany as a herd mentality moment, or Napoleon's revolution, the Crusades, or Nero's persecution of the early Christians. Herd mentality in this way often appeals to our basest reactionary selves, that which is devoid of reasoning, where facts and truth don't matter. Neither does right or wrong. People that get caught up in herd mentality often describe themselves as caught or trapped, moved along as if pulled by a giant wave, only to look back and not know the person they were in that moment. Not to mention feeling a great deal of shame because, had rationality been a part of the picture, they never would have been a part of the act. The gravitational pull of mob mentality is irresistible. This juxtaposition of human helplessness and weakness with the capacity as a group to do great and strange and terrible things. It can happen anytime, to anyone, in any place. The greatest and worst of leaders have the capacity to incite herd mentality at will. They tap into people's deepest fears, dreams, needs, longings, and frustrations. They say, it's time for hope and change. Or, make America great again. Or, I have a dream. Or, be the change you wish to see in the world. Or simply, peace be with you. And, go make disciples of all nations. anytime, anywhere, anyone. Because of what's beneath all those fears, all those dreams, all those needs, those frustrations, is this creation-specific hardwiring for connection. Herd mentality is just a manifestation of the fundamental God dust that each one of us is made of, that draws us to one another, that need to belong to each other. For in that belonging, there is protection, purpose, and power. So Jesus said, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. He didn't say it to isolated individuals. He said it to his band, his herd, on a regular day, on a nondescript mountaintop, anywhere, anytime. And he said it not to the 12, but to 11. That's remarkable, because when we hear the number 11 as the ones Jesus is talking to, we automatically have to remember that someone's missing. It's not a complete group. They aren't perfect. And yet Jesus still gives them the mission to go and make disciples. All they have is their trust in his authority and each other to get them started on their way. Go, therefore, baptizing all nations in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. Go, be faithful, not as individuals, but as pairs, as trios, as groups, as herds, to other people, other groups, to all nations. Share the good news that no one is ever alone, and ask them, have you heard that Jesus was raised from the dead? I've tried to figure out why the COW Project for World Hunger took off the way that it did. I've wondered if we figure out the mix of circumstances and timing and people and communication, could we replicate it with other projects that we want to do? That way, anytime we want to pull something off as a synod or as congregations, or as a whole ELCA, or as a church, we could go back and replicate this enthusiasm and package it and pull it out whenever we need it and just sprinkle it for good measure on every half-baked, hopeful idea we risked trying. You think Jesus had some of it that he sprinkled on to the 11 that day? We know their mission was and continues to be strong. Herds of Jesus followers all over the globe, despite many mobs in history trying to squash it. People doing the work of healing and feeding and remembering the forgotten and sheltering the homeless and fighting for justice for those who are oppressed. Let's zoom in to our synod, one such herd of Jesus followers, part of a much bigger herd, the ELCA, which is part of a much bigger herd, the body of Christ in the world. When we chose the theme, Never Alone, for our assembly, we had lots of different ways of talking about it. Of course, there's the promise that Jesus is with us always to the end of the age. There's also the promise that we have one another as a church, and there's the hope and the mission to serve others, never alone. It was my hope in choosing this theme that we as congregations would look at the way we do ministry, that we would see ourselves not as islands, self-sufficient as congregations, but as congregations who need one another, help each other, and do ministry together. Not because we have to or because we don't have enough money to do it ourselves, but because we want to, and because that's the way to be faithful doing ministry. It's my dream for congregations, especially those who are struggling, that they would share staff and space, and that they would have other congregations celebrate with them when things are worth celebrating, and grieve with them when things are worth grieving. It's very possible in the next decade that a number of our synod's congregations would see that the most faithful way to do ministry will be to close their doors. How will we, as other congregations, be with them when that happens? How will we welcome them? How will we pray for them? Or will we let them just do it alone? The Great Commission is given to the 74 congregations of the La Crosse Area Synod. Go be disciples. Go be faithful. All we have is our trust in Jesus and each other. I want to challenge every congregation of our synod to do something new with another congregation. Whether it's in our synod or in your neighborhood, I don't care. Find something meaningful to do together this year. And as you're doing it, remember that you are never alone and that you are a part of Jesus' herd. Beware of herd mentality that seeks anything but faithfulness, anything but love for God and love for our neighbors. You know the kind I'm talking about. The kind that yells, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Sometimes, too often, we reflect that mob. But Jesus, the mob crucified one, calls us again and again to hear ourselves forgiven, to say, "Peace be with you." To say, "Go tell everyone I am with you." Be faithful. Invite them to know Jesus. Ask them, "Have you heard?" Amen. As you are able, please stand for the singing of hymn 579. Hymn 579.
Thank you.
saying the Apostles' Creed found on page 105 in the front of your hymnal, page 105. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified and died in the Spirit. He descended into the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray for the Church, those in need, and all of God's creation.
Faithful God, inspire fidelity in your church. Guard it from temptation and make it a place of safety, welcome, and joy for all. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of all that is, we encounter you not only in the grandeur of your creation, but its smallest and quietest parts. Awaken us to your presence all around us. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of power and might, call the nations of the world to recognize first your authority and justice, guard all nations from unjust rulers, and bring forth your kingdom of righteousness and peace. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of the lowly, help us recognize hospitality and generosity from unexpected sources, the humanity and goodness of those in prison, the faith and persistence of those who weep. Let our weakness be our strength. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of new life, that you bring newcomers, visitors, and seekers into this assembly, give us hearts open to the new perspectives and gifts they bring. Lord, in your mercy.
God of the isolated, surround those who are alone and hold on with your loving embrace. Especially this week, we pray for Yolanda and Elaine. Fill them with the gifts of light and hope. Lord, in your mercy.
Thank you.
all wait upon you and your open hand in blessing. Fill us with good things at your table, that we may come to help of all in need, through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer and Lord.
Amen.
Please join with me in the prayer that our Lord taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Moses stood before a burning bush, protesting God's call upon him. Who am I to go to Pharaoh to free the children of Israel? What will I say when they ask who sent me? Oh God, I beg of you, send someone else. I heard the voice of God saying, whom shall I send? Who will go for us?
And I said, here am I, send me.
A child once dreamed that God called him by name, Samuel. Jeremiah stood in despair before God, who had appointed him a prophet, while he was still within his mother's womb. Sovereign God, I don't know how to speak to the nations. I am too young. I heard the voice of God saying, whom shall I send? Who will go for us?
And I said, here am I, send me.
Mary stood before God's messenger, amazed at the news she was hearing. But how is it possible for this to take place? Yet I am God's servant, so let it be done as you have said. I heard the voice of God saying, whom shall I send? Who will go for us?
And I said, here am I, send me.
Fisherfolk from the Galilean Sea once met a young man who told them to lay aside their nets and follow. I heard the voice of God saying, whom shall I send? Who will go for us?
And I said, here am I, send me.
Mary Magdalene stood in joyous tears before the risen Christ, framing the message she would bring to her grieving companions. I have seen the Lord. I heard the voice of God saying, whom shall I send? Who will go for us?
And I said, here am I, send me.
Let us pray. Direct us, O Lord, in all our doings with your most gracious favor, and further us with your continual help, that in all our works, begun, continued, and ended in you, we may glorify your holy name, and finally, by your mercy, obtain everlasting life through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Lord God, our Father, you kept Abraham and Sarah in safety throughout the days of their pilgrimage. You led the children of Israel through the midst of the sea, and by a star, you led wise men to the infant Jesus. Protect and guide us now in this time as we set out to travel. Make our ways safe and our homecomings joyful, and bring us at last to our heavenly home, where you dwell in glory with your Son and the Holy Spirit, God forever.
Amen.
Jesus said to his disciples,
Lord, I am with you always, even to the end of the age.
Go in peace. Christ is with you.
And thanks be to God.
Please sit.
There are a few other announcements. A number of them are listed in the back of the bulletin. One thing I failed to mention earlier, also please include Kay Oseki in your prayers. Also, to the basket of flowers here is from Carolyn Baldwin's funeral on Friday. One special item that I wanted to bring to your attention that's in the bulletin is the special congregational meeting, which will be next Sunday after the 10 o'clock service. It's in regard to some sidewalk repairs around the church. There's nothing else that I need to announce, and if you could please rise for our final hymn.